If you ask a typical college student, "Why do you eat?" you'd probably get a variety of responses. "I eat because I'm hungry," or "I eat because I'm bored," or "I eat because I'm mad at my boyfriend or girlfriend." But none of these answers is sufficiently biological for someone taking this class, and by now you should know the proper way to answer this question. You eat to obtain three things. First, you eat to obtain energy. Sugars, polysaccharides, proteins, fats, and oils. These all get broken down to make ATP energy. How much energy do we need? Well, energy will be measured here in units called kilocalories, and this is the same as the familiar calories on food packaging. In physical sciences terms, this is the amount of energy needed to raise 1 kilogram of water by 1 degree Celsius. Part of your daily energy requirement is needed just to keep your body alive and warm, with all of your physiological systems functioning at minimal level. If you were in a coma with no brain activity or very little brain activity, this would be about your rate of energy consumption, and we call this your basal metabolism. And it varies from person to person based on age, gender, but mostly body size. For example, a comatose adult female of 115 pounds would probably need about 1400 calories per day. A bigger person would need more calories, a smaller one less. Now, apart from these minimal energy requirements, any activity beyond just being alive, including such activities as being awake, digesting coffee and pastries while you're studying biology and ice skating at the same time, all of these add to your energetic requirements. The more demanding the activity, the greater the energetic needs. A moderately active male, 160-pound college student would probably have a need for something like 2,400 to 3,200 calories per day. A triathlete who's training for a big race by running, swimming, biking daily may need upwards of 5,000 calories. The second thing we absolutely must get from the food we ingest is the raw materials for a biosynthetic work, such as making all the parts of the cells for maintenance and growth. And the third thing that overlaps somewhat with the second is that we rely on our diets to provide specific substances that our bodies need but cannot make. For example, 9 out of the 20 amino acids that are required for protein synthesis are identified as essential amino acids because they cannot be made from scratch by the biosynthetic pathways in our human physiology. So, in order to make our proteins, we need to import these amino acids from the food that we take in. To give you an example, we can't make the amino acid lysine, but we need lysine to make our protein. Maybe you ate some peanut butter today. The protein content of peanut butter, as well as lots of other legumes, that is, vegetables in the bean and pea family, are lysine rich. In breaking apart the peanut proteins, you undoubtedly got and absorbed some lysine that is presently being incorporated into the proteins of your body. Let's think for a bit on this human inability to make the amino acid lysine. And remember that there are 8 other amino acids that we also can't make, as well as many other essential nutrients. Our inability to make these compounds might seem like it could be a huge problem, but really it isn't. When you think about the context of natural selection that has given shape to human physiology, the diversity of foods that our ancestors have eaten just in order to meet their caloric needs would have provided all of these nutrients. We don't need to synthesize lysine because we have a long history of getting all the lysine that we need from our food. The enzymatic machinery required to produce lysine is about as useless to us as the eyes are for the blind cavefish, and mutation has taken the ability away. We probably did have, at some point in our evolutionary histories, the ability to synthesize lysine. Plants, fungi, as well as most kinds of single-celled life forms, have this ability. Now, as it turns out, all animals lack the ability to synthesize at least some out of the 20 amino acids. And all vertebrates share the same set of 9 essential amino acids, with lysine being one of them. You might be wondering about herbivores and their ability to meet their amino acid requirements from their very low protein diets. Remember that vegetable matter tends to be rather low in protein content. Herbivores are, almost without exception, either ruminants or hindgut fermenters, like the koala that we talked about earlier. Bacteria, in their specialized gut compartments, consume the vegetable matter and make their own proteins out of a complete set of amino acids that the bacteria are able to synthesize. Unlike us, many bacteria have the ability to make all 20 amino acids. Digesting the bacterial protein, herbivores get a mixture containing all of the essential amino acids. Omnivores like humans and carnivores like bears don't have specialized fermentive chambers in their guts, and so we don't get too much nutrition from digested bacteria. Herbivores do, and they rely on bacteria as a very important protein supplement to the veggies that they consume. So our human digestive anatomies are not well suited to take advantage of the protein content of hindgut bacteria. So a person following a strictly vegan diet would need to include some protein-rich food items, such as nuts, into his or her diet. Now, in addition to essential amino acids, we also cannot make mineral nutrients or vitamins, which are organic cofactors that are required for certain necessary biochemical reactions. Here is a table of minerals and vitamins needed by humans. A diet that's deficient in any of these substances will result in adverse health effects, and you'll be seeing this in the nutrition laboratory. People who adopt a strictly vegan diet must make a very special effort to complete their nutritional requirements. Certain nutrients are very difficult to acquire from purely vegetable matter. We already know that vegetable material tends to be low in protein, but a person always has the option of selecting those items that are relatively rich in protein, like tofu or peanut butter. However, at least one vitamin, B12, is practically impossible to get from a purely plant-based diet, and a B12 deficiency causes a condition known as pernicious anemia, which is one of the most serious and most common nutritional deficiencies experienced by vegans. Most vegans either know this and make that special effort to meet this need, or they find out about it when they're hit by declining health. When you think about how bad it is to be malnourished, the effects ranging from general weakness to blindness to effective blood clotting mechanisms, and this huge list of essential nutrients, it may seem initially kind of surprising that our ancestors were able to stay alive and healthy at all. Somehow they're able to meet all of those dietary requirements, and they did so without daily multivitamin supplements. In the modern human diet, a great deal of what we eat is based on refined starches, sugars, and oils. White starches come from a more complete source of nutrition, whole grains, from which only the starch is isolated. First, the bran and the germ are removed, and then the more nutritional outer layers of the grain are polished away until what you have left is a lump that has a very neutral flavor. This is your grain of white rice, or the part of the wheat grain that gets ground into flour. It's the absence of flavor that makes refined starches so desirable. White starch is a great source for calories, but in making it, we're throwing away the outer layers of grain that have a higher content of protein and essential nutrients. Sugars and oils are similarly high-calorie, low-essential nutrient extractions coming from more complete food sources. And this practice of refining the nutrition out of foods is a relatively recent thing, and it's unique to our species. For a human living a few thousand years ago under primitive conditions, taking in 2,200 calories worth of food would have meant taking in a lot more nutritional diversity, as compared with 2,200 calories worth of Cheetos, donuts, and beer. In this regard, the idea of avoiding white foods, that is, white flour, white sugar, and white rice, And meeting your daily caloric needs with whole foods really is sound nutritional advice. Now, we've talked about pernicious anemia, but nutritional deficiency associated with veganism is not a predominant health concern for the human population in the United States. With the abundant availability and consumption of high-calorie, low-nutrition foods, it's not surprising that we see a far greater incidence of unhealthy eating habits in which a person consumes too many calories while at the same time not meeting all the nutritional requirements. A combination of overnourishment and malnutrition. And yes, they can both occur at the same time. We'll talk about this more in the next video.